Oh, bear my longing heart to him who bled and died for me, whose blood now cleanses from all sin and gives me victory.
Oh, come, angel band, come.
Went down and the jungle fire was burning. Down the track came a hobo hiking, and he said, "Boys, I'm not turning. I'm headed for a land that's far away, beside the crystal fountains. So come with me, we'll go and see the big rock candy mountains. In the big rock candy mountains, there's a land that's fair and bright, where the handouts grow on bushes and you sleep out every night, where the boxcars all are empty and the sun shines every day on the birds and the bees and the cigarette trees, the lemonade springs where the bluebird sings in the big rock candy mountains. In the big rock candy mountains, all the cops have wooden legs and the bulldogs all have rubber teeth and the hens lay soft-boiled eggs. The farmer's trees are full of fruit and the barns are full of hay. Oh, I'm bound to go where there ain't no snow, where the rain don't fall, the wind don't blow, in the big rock candy mountains. In the big rock candy mountains, you never change your socks, and the little streams of alcohol come a-trickling down the rocks. The brakemen have to tip their hats and the railroad bulls are blind. There's a lake of stew and a whiskey too. You can paddle all around them in a big canoe in the big rock candy mountains. In the big rock candy mountains, the jails are made of tin, and you can walk right out again as soon as you are in. There ain't no short-handled shovels, no axes, saws, or picks. I'm a-going to stay where you sleep all day, where they hung the Turk that invented work in the big rock candy mountains. I'll see you all this coming fall in the big rock candy mountains.
Well, thank you all for coming. I'm Dennis Harper, curator of collections and exhibitions here at the museum. And we welcome you to our evening's program. We are very pleased to have a special guest tonight, Dr. Ed Hayes, who will be talking about his passion for art and where it has led him over the last several decades. One small example, the result of which is on view in our Wadsworth and Chi Omega galleries. If you haven't seen it yet, it's part of the Auburn Collects series of exhibitions, selections from the Ed Hayes collection. I don't want to step on Dr. Hayes's speech, talk about himself, so I'll only briefly cover his biography. He is a physician by trade and by profession, but at his core is a historian and a true connoisseur of culture. He has a particular interest for things that relate to the South, Southern artists, Southern subject matter, and issues that were pertinent to the history of this region, of which he is a native. He had a difficult choice, as we did, in selecting the works for the exhibition, because the collection is quite large and extensive. Like the cover of the brochure of a river baptism, the collection is both broad and very deep, and we had limited space. And Ed has chosen several, about a half dozen works that are his favorites, even if it's hard to choose your favorites from among your favorite children, that he's going to talk about tonight. So please join me in welcoming a great friend to the museum, a wonderful person, Dr. Ed Hayes. You don't need to double mic.
We got it. I'm not sure I need this microphone, but when the crowd starts showing up, if y'all don't mind scooting in a little bit, I'd appreciate it. After I finish talking, I'm going to have Dennis to stand back with an offertory plate, and Bob Eklund's going to return a final prayer for us. I want to start out by just telling you a little bit about how I got into collecting and what some of the trials, tribulations of trying to develop any collection is for somebody when they're in the process. I started collecting probably when I was 6 years old, 7 years old, from everything from pennies. You remember the little blue things you could stick your pennies in when you do that? Coin collecting, baseball cards, marbles. My baseball cards really draw a very, very tearful time of my life. I had collected baseball cards since I was 6 or 7 years old up till I went off to college. I had numerous Nolan Ryan rookie cards. I had Joe DiMaggio. I had Mickey Mantle rookie cards. I had some things that were just, today would be worth a small fortune. I went off to Clemson for my first semester. I came back at Christmas, and still the little kid in me, I wanted to look at my baseball cards again. And I said, Mother, I said, where are my baseball cards? I had about four shoe boxes full. She said, hon, those things were in the way. I said, what? She said, yeah, I threw them in trash right after you left. So I lost my my baseball card collection. My mother is still alive, yes. At that time, the thought didn't go through my mind. When I went to Clemson, and actually from the time I was young, and as you will notice, a lot of my paintings have, or works of art, both paintings and works on paper, do have a lot of black subjects in the paintings. I was raised in upstate South Carolina in an environment not unlike what we saw with the movie The Help. I remember when I was a kid growing up, there was a little black boy that would come over and work on the farm that my great-grandmother had he and I were the same age, and his name was Ben. And Ben and I would be playing out in the yard all day, all the time. And if I went in to get a drink of water, Ben wouldn't come. And, which was it was very disconcerting to a kid, because he was a nice fella, and he and I always had a good time and played well together. But my great-grandmother was of the ilk that the help didn't come inside the house. And as a matter of fact, there was a separate dipper out on the well for the people that were working in the field. So I didn't really understand that. And then I when I went to Clemson, I met a wonderful, wonderful professor. His name was Alexander Holt. He was kind of a professor emeritus in the Department of English and taught humanities. And anytime he taught a course, I took it. He taught in the black humanities, kind of a broad spectrum course. He did a whole course on just black literature. And we read Ralph Ellison, Richard Wright, the autobiography of Malcolm X, just to name some of the works that we did, and gained a total new perspective for really the whole black plight in the South and what people were going through. And a lot of the paintings that we'll talk about, or that you'll see, have dealt with that social realism, the problems that we had. And a lot of the artists that are represented One we'll talk about in particular, Prentice Taylor, but Ann Goldthwaite, were all civil rights activists back long before that was a popular subject, and were very important members of the Harlem Renaissance at that time. So that's how my foundation, when I finally started collecting paintings, I had met a lady in Charleston. I really started collecting books and maps before I got into collecting works of art seriously. I had some, but she introduced me really to, from dealing with her with maps, she called me up one day and said, would you like to buy two Alice Ravenel Hughie Smiths? And I said, who's that? So, and kind of the preeminent watercolorist of the Charleston Renaissance. And I said, sure. So that was really my first purchase of any significant artwork. Those I no longer have. That's why they're not here, because there was a guy that was starting a collection that wanted them much more than I did. So he wound up acquiring those. But that kind of started my interest. Then I had an opportunity to, she continued to find me different things. She found me a whole book of studies of Harrison Katie, which I subsequently traded to another Charleston dealer. And from then I kind of got the bug. At that time I got a huge Huddy, one of his northern ones, but that kind of started me in the pathway of wanting to collect more. And I think what put the crowning blow on my collecting was that back in the early 90s, my accountants had said, well, you need to get a financial attorney in here and do all this tax estate planning. And sure enough, he came in and worked for hours and hours and hours. And lo and behold, when he came back, he says, well, you need to set up this real estate trust, and you need to set up this insurance trust, and you need to do this, and you need to do that. And I said, look, I said, you know, I wasn't born with a silver spoon in my mouth, and I worked hard, and I wanted to have something that I enjoyed. So rather than doing tying up everything in non-taxable or limited tax, I said, I'm just going to start buying artwork. This is where it gets very, very interesting for the novice collector, because you've got to watch who you deal with. It goes without saying, in the art world, there are an awful lot of nice people, but there are some shysters, frank crooks. And I met two of the biggest in early on, and I'm not going to call any names for fear of legal retribution. I know one of them has done time for his, and the other one should have. Fortunately enough, and I do give credit to and thank Dave and Debbie for coming down. Dave Kanoki from Atlanta is here, and I recognize him because he has been very integral in helping to develop what you see here. David and I started our association friendship in 1995-1996 time frame. And since that time, if you look at just the pictures that are in the gallery, excluding the works on paper, almost half of the paintings were acquired through my association with David, either directly from him or from contacts he had. And just a couple of, one neat story that I've always appreciated. I'm at home one afternoon, and I was telling Dennis about this a while ago, and Dave was there, and my phone rings, and it's David, and he said, do you know an artist named Thomas B. Welch? And that's the little lady that's out there in the, and I said, nope. So, well, I said, the guy says he's a Charleston artist. And I said, okay. He said, and I can get it for you. And he told me a price. And I said, okay. He said, well, I'm in Paris. I said, what? He had found this painting of Thomas Welch, of this lady, in a market, an outdoor market in Paris, and sure enough, I wound up, well, as you can see, I got it. But he did that on a number of things. And one other very interesting thing is he called me up another day and he said, do you know two individuals named Theodosia Burr Alston and Joseph Alston? I said, yeah, I do. He said, well, I've got their engagement portraits here. And I said, what? He said, their engagement portraits. And sure enough, they're limnerist type paintings, and again, not here today, but are wonderful pieces and so a very valuable part of South Carolina history. And from there, I guess the rest is just continuing to develop. Again, most of the or significant portion of my collection has come through David, and from all over the country, really, via auctions, a few pickers, and some just private sales that I've been lucky enough to run across. With that said, at this point, does anybody have any questions whatsoever? I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
As African American subjects have become more popular, are you finding that there's an increase in forgeries as in any other popular field of art, and particularly because African American artists were probably less likely be represented through the traditional gallery provenance? What steps do you try to, you know, to ensure that if what they really see, if it ends up on, you know, in the flea market in Paris, I guess is what I'm saying.
You know, I really haven't seen that, and most of the, even though I do have some works that are by African American artists, most of the works are not by African Americans. They're by Caucasian painters that were depicting the African Americans, and most of them that I have, I can honestly say that I haven't seen an increase in forgeries of that type painting. I will tell you though that the price line has certainly risen, and the demand for because there at one time was a paucity of African American subjects in the paintings. So finding it is harder, and when you do find it, expect to pay more than what you did 15 years ago. Would you say that's pretty well true, Mr. Kanoki?
Yes, sir.
With that said, we're going to talk about six different artists, and they're all, actually all of them that I'm going to talk about are in your booklet. And I won't expound on them an awful lot, but I'd like to tell you some facts about the artist. And I'm doing this more for the fact that these people and a lot of people in this collection were very, very important in the art world, but you've never heard of them. You know, some of them have sold two paintings, and yet if you look at their bios, they're extensive. So it's not so much, your popularity is not really predicated on what you've really done. So there are people that I won't mention, that or I will mention briefly, but one in particular that stands out, and it's one of the little etchings that's back in by Alexander Smith. He was essentially I just found the etching and thought it was neat. Well, this gentleman was the first African American to graduate from the National Academy of Design. He subsequently went to Europe during World War I and was in France, came back to New York, was not happy, then went back to Paris and spent the rest of his life in France. He was also the first, is probably, and that's a probably, but he is one of the first African Americans that was ever recorded doing an etching. So, you know, I'd never heard of Alexander Smith. How many of you had heard of Alexander Smith? That's the way with a lot of these artists in my collection. I'm going to start with this painting, Maximum Security, that was done by Prentice Taylor. Prentice Taylor was an interesting gentleman. He was born in Washington, D.C. in 1907. In the 20s, he went to New York to the Art Student League and studied under Charles Hawthorne. By the late 20s, he had pretty well given up on, even though he did paint with oils, he had become more involved with lithography and eventually became one of the preeminent lithographers of the time. He worked with arms. He worked with Martin Lewis, and was considered one of the best at his trade at that time. He's also important to the South in that he came down to Charleston in the early 1930s, 1934 to be exact. And he, along with two other people that are represented in the collection, George Biddle and Palmer Chappe, were instrumental in being kind of secondary artists and very important to the Charleston Renaissance movement. He also was an important figure in the Harlem Renaissance movement. He was friends, very close friends, with Langston Hughes. And he and Langston Hughes actually started a publishing company together at one time. He was friends with multiple people in that area, Eugene O'Neill, Diego Rivera. Let's see, just a few more that... Ramir Bearden, Paul Cadmus, Ezra Pound. And he, interestingly enough, also has a Alabama connection in that he was very close friends, even though there was quite a disparity in their age, he was very close friends with Ann Goldthwait, who at that time was expounding her views on the inequities among races and the inequalities with the impoverished people and how they were treated. So he was the first real social realist that we have. He depicted realistic and narrative scenes that reflected his views on generally anything from music to architecture, but more importantly to the actual civil disturbances and the politics of that time. He subsequently moved back to Washington, where he taught oil paintings at the American University for over 20 years. He was the president of the Washington Etchers Society for 34 years. And ultimately, he passed away in Washington at the age of 84 years old. This particular picture actually came from his estate. And this is, during his life, he worked as an art therapist at mental institutions in the Washington area. This is St. Elizabeth's Asylum, which was used to house criminals that were people that were considered criminally insane. The guy right here in the front is Ezra Pound, or is purportedly Ezra Pound, let's put that, who had been imprisoned for some of his dissident views on the United States politics in the late 40s. A very interesting piece, and there's an awful lot happening in here and a lot of symbolism. And it's kind of got everything that you can be doing together. Plus, at this point in time, this painting was done in 1948, and I think it was exhibited in a show at the Carnegie Institute at that time. But you have no one thought about integrating prisoners at that point in time. Most of the, or all of the penitentiaries were still segregated. But in where you got a bunch of crazy criminals, you got them all living together. So, I mean, there's a statement there. You've got people walking around nude. You have people that we really don't know what's happening. You've got symbolism with the black and white sheets, the bars, the gentleman chasing the bird, thinking maybe for freedom. Just a close-up of Ezra Pound. Some of the other things, a card game going on, fights breaking out. Excuse me. So that's kind of the story on Prentice Ellis, a very important figure, yet very little is, you never hear him. He's definitely not a household name. The next person I want to talk about is this gentleman, Stephen Ferris. Ferris was born in 1935 and he lived to 1915. He went to Philadelphia at about age 21 and enrolled at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts under, worked under Thomas Aikens at that time. He was also exposed to John Sartain and was a very, very important etcher. He was a huge collector of etchings, and at his death he had a collection of over 2,000 pieces of artwork that dated all the way from Rembrandt up to his present day. He was a noted engraver. He was also a portrait painter. He painted, again, over 2,000 portraits during his lifetime. So he was very, very prolific. He did go to Paris, and he studied under the famous Jean-Léon Gérôme in Paris, who was a very academic figural painter. They were so close that he ultimately named his son after Gérôme, who ultimately became a very important American historical painter. He had a daughter named Mary Electra that also was a painter. This present picture appeared in the, I'm going to tell you a story about the Great Central Sanitary Fair in 1864 in Philadelphia. And this is when this painting was accomplished. The sanitary fairs in the North were conducted by the United States Sanitary Commission and the Christian Commission, and they were in the major cities across the Northeast. And these were conducted to provide relief to the families of wounded soldiers and to help the war efforts. This fair was held in June of 1864, and at that time there were 1,500 artists represented at this fair. This is a small picture for you that have seen the collection know, but it's a very allegorical and a very telling picture. In this fair, there was a thing called the Civil War album. In that, he had another small picture called Liberty Triumphant. This was not part of that, but did appear in the show. The painting itself is, as I said, there's a lot going on, and I'll show you some close-ups. But you've got the black figure here, obviously, who has taken off his uniform. And at this time, remember, 1864, they started planning the fair right after Gettysburg. So the South was already having some real trouble at that point in time. And it was felt that the end was imminent at that point. He had taken off his uniform, and now he's getting ready to have a good time. And as you'll see here, it says, there's a good time coming. And here is the little plantation bell is leaving the scene, departing. You'll see plantation bitters right here. This figure here, I have no idea what this hieroglyphic figure is for. But Mammy's going to make sure that he keeps working, and it's not going to be all good times and just an easy time for him. You can see her, a very well-painted figure. Him. And then in the back, well, this is the female. In the back, you'll see that, Here's a black lady that's taking care of a baby, and she's still doing her duties just like it was. So to me, this whole painting is saying, yeah, it might be over, but that part's over. But the rest is yet to come. And we're not out of this mode yet. So this fair ultimately raised over $1 million, which was an unheard of sum at that time. The next painting I'd like to talk is on the cover of the catalog. And this is the baptismal scene by John Pike. I had never heard of John Pike before, and I thought I was fairly knowledgeable. And about 5 years or so ago, I got a call from a lady that I'd bought some pictures through in Woodstock and said, would you like to see a baptismal scene? And I said, sure. I said, who's it by? She said, John Pike. I said, who is that? So this is how I acquired this piece, was from a picker in Woodstock, New York. Well, when I started reading about John Pike was born in 1911. He lived to 1979. He was born in Massachusetts, and ultimately he went to the Art Students League like just about everybody did. Most of these artists and most of the artists in my collection either went through the Art Students League, the National Academy of Design, or the Pennsylvania Academy. Those were the kind of the preeminent periods of that. And most of the artists in my collection, I'll just digress a minute here. To be in my collection, you just about have to be dead. I've got 3 living artists in my collection. One is Sigmund Abeles, one of the faces in the urns, if you saw here during the first one, during the carousel, was one of them. He paints in New York, interesting character. He was very, very active in civil rights, and he was at the University of South Carolina. He lived in Myrtle Beach. And in 1953, when he was a sophomore, they told him if he would move to New York, they would give him a degree in fine arts from the University of South Carolina. So he went to New York and finished his training there. The second living artist is a black artist named Wadsworth Jarrell. And then I have by Clint Herring, and hopefully he's going to be around for a while. So Pike, just a little bit on Pike. He was went to the Art Students League. Then when he was 22, he went to Jamaica, stayed for 5 years, doing advertising, designing bars, theaters for rum companies there. Married and came back to New York. And about this time, the war was cranking up. He became a pilot, a fighter pilot in the Army Air Corps, but because of his artistic ability, he was made the head of the combat art section of the Corps of Engineers, and depicted the invasion and control of Korea in 1945. That body of work is almost totally in the hands of the War Department now. He then went to work for the Air Force and went all over the world, England, Germany, Greenland, Formosa, Japan, doing works there. And for 15 years he did this. And he is, and this body of work is in the museum at the Air Force Academy in Colorado. He illustrated for Collier's, Life, Fortune Magazine, Reader's Digest, did advertisement for Alcoa, Standard Oil, National Cash Register, General Tire, and we're dating ourselves. How many people remember Falstaff beer? See, they don't. He did a lot of figure work for Falstaff as well. He was a member of the National Academy of Design, the Salomon Gundy Club, the American Water Color Society, the Society of Illustrators, the Woodstock Art Association, and many others. And he won so many awards that they're just too numerous to count. He was recognized by the American Water Color Society, the National Academy of Design, and it goes on and on and on. He ultimately started a school, the John Pike Watercolor School, in Woodstock in 1960, which he operated until 1969. And at that time, he died suddenly. And during that time, he had a company that was, it was vacation paintings, where he would take groups of artists to Europe, and they would travel and sketch and do this painting holidays is what it was called. This man, as wonderful as this painting is, has only 7 paintings at auction that have brought more than $1,000. So he was great, he had all the accolades, but never really has had any notoriety whatsoever. I think his paintings were, you can see they have a feeling of solitude, but yet they contain human elements. And I think this is very evident in this wonderful baptismal scene. Even though you see the group up in the corner, this is almost like they're all alone here in this quiet, placid river. And there is definitely an uplifting feeling about this painting. Just close-ups. And the ladies in the back. The next guy I'm going to talk about is a guy that named Felix Octavius Carr Darley. His illustrations are known all over the world, yet most people have never heard his name. You know, Darley was born in Philadelphia of a family of actually actors. They were very into the arts and theater. He really had minimal formal training. He was self-taught and taught himself using anatomic figures and classic European works on paper, old master drawings. He illustrated, just to give you some idea of the magnitude of his illustrating, for Washington Irving, he did The Legend of Sleepy Hollow. For Henry Longfellow, Evangeline. James Fenimore Cooper, he did over 350 drawings for multiple of Cooper's books. Nathaniel Hawthorne, The Scarlet Letter. Edgar Allan Poe, The Gold Bug. And we'll talk a little bit more about Edgar Allan Poe. Charles Dickens, Oliver Twist. Who knows who Clement Clark Moore is? You do? Who is he?
Didn't he write the Magna Carta?
He certainly did, which was originally a visit from St. Nicholas. He did the first illustrations for Clement Clark Moore, and then one that I guess I probably shouldn't mention in this crowd, but he also did illustrations for Harriet Beecher Stowe in Uncle Tom's Cabin. So he covered the gamut of the authors that were important at that time. At age 16, he went to work for Graham's Women's and Men's Magazine in Philadelphia. And there he was working with John Sartain, Edgar Allan Poe, and Thomas Sully. Now, that whole, the Sully, Poe, Darley families had gone back for years. In the late 1700s, all of those families had migrated from England and were actors. So they had known each other for a long time. Plus, Darley's older brother married Thomas Sully's daughter. So there was a lot of things. And they were each, Sully and Poe, were very, very supportive of this young man and his efforts. As a matter of fact, Poe and Darley became so close that Darley considered him his older brother. The first real thing he did of any significance was that he did by himself was a group of studies on the sketches of Indian life, where he depicted the noble savage. He had never seen an Indian when he did it. So he was a gifted artist. He remained in Philadelphia until 1949 and then went to New York because that's where most of the publishers were, so he was closer to them. He designed some bills for the United States Treasury and ultimately married in 1854 and moved to Delaware, where he resided until his death in 1888. While in Delaware, his paths crossed with the gifted and well-known illustrator Howard Pyle. Howard Pyle was 7 when Darley moved to Delaware, and it is felt that he had a significant impact on Pyle's eventual choice of careers. He died in 1888, as I said. He was drawing at the time. So he completed over 4,000 drawings in his life. And I think all you can say, I do want to read this to you, what a noted art scholar said about him, that his work brought life into the scene, whether his medium was pencil, ink wash, or oil. That he drew in a free and spontaneous manner, in a romantic spirit, invariably capturing the essential point or flavor of the scene to be portrayed. He challenged the dominance of the English and European illustrations of his era. I think had this man been in Europe at the time, and Dennis and I were talking about it, no doubt his accolades would be much more known than they are today. Again, this particular picture is called Foraging in Virginia. And it shows the Northern soldiers coming down and just reconnoitering whatever they want from the farm. And again, his execution was good. I mean, his figures were great, but there were always comedic figures in there. You see all sorts of different disgruntled individuals, but all in all, a very wonderful illustration. Just a little close-up of some of the detail that he used in his techniques. And again, look at the detail of the faces that are just really, he's mad, he's happy, he's stupid. So, now we're going to talk about, we've talked about four now, we have two more to go. This is William Carl Anthony Frerich. Frerich was born in Ghent in the Netherlands in 1829. He went to his father was a general in the army, so he was really of kind of landed gentry. He went to the Royal Academy there at age 6. Ultimately went to the University of Leiden, where he did 3 years of medicine, came back to the academy, and started his art career again. At the age of 18, he completed a 12 by 17 foot commission painting for the Emperor of Russia. By the 1850, he had decided to leave the Netherlands and come to America, where he came to New York. He exhibited one painting there, and this is the only record of any shows that he ever participated in. And it is, I have two sources. One says 1852, the other is 1854. I think the 1854s have it, but they're two different dates that conflict. In 1855, he went to Greensboro, North Carolina, went to the Greensboro Woman's College, where he was the teaching art. From there, he took forays out into to Western North Carolina, and mainly around the French Broad River area, where he depicted these raging streams. Definitely was a Hudson River type painter, but whereas being exposed to people like Church, Cropsey, Ennis, he never really was involved with the Hudson River School in North Carolina. But he painted these type scenes of generally raging waters with the diminutive figure of man in the front. He taught at Greensboro until 1865. His studio burned in 1863, and he was ultimately served in the Confederate Corps of Engineers. After the war, he went back to New York because trying to make a living as an artist in North Carolina at that time was impossible right after the war. He went back to Staten Island, where he lived until 1905. And again, even though the Hudson River School, I think the term Hudson River School was coined in 1879, he would have been right in the heart of that time period, never really exhibited in any of the shows with any of the other known artists of that period. This particular one is a very large painting. It is, as you see, the raging waters, with the fisherman here, called what, Fishing in the title of the painting is Dennis, Fishing in the something. Anyway, it's a North Carolina picture. So if there's anything else I would like to tell you about him, I don't think so. Oh yeah, he would have had a lot more, been more prolific, but the Indians kept stealing his sketches. So when he was up in the mountains, he had all kind of problems. Our last painter that I want to make a few comments about is Elliot Dangerfield. And that, he's one of those people that, as far as Southern art, and really American art in general, I think is larger than life. He's never really gotten the full acclaim that he needs, and is just as of late is kind of coming into his own. Elliot Dangerfield was born in Harpers Ferry, West Virginia in 1859. And his father was ultimately wound up in the Confederate Army. And when he was 1 year old, they moved to Fayetteville, North Carolina. Even as a boy, he had artistic prowess. He was a sign painter. He painted porcelain and ultimately went to the Art Students League to work under Walter Satterley when he was 21 years old. In New York, he met and became close friends with George Ennis. He was also working in the same studio as Ralph Blakelock and Albert Pinkham Ryder. So he surrounded himself amongst some fairly unusual individuals of his day. He married when he was just early in his career. He was more known as the American Malay. And if we look at this picture here, this is one that was done in the 1880s, and it was very typical of the subject matter, very genre-esque painting that he would do at that time. He married, and his first wife, who was from Wilmington, North Carolina, ultimately died in childbirth in 1891. And at that point in time, he went into sort of a deep depression. And that's when he started painting his allegorical, religious-type pictures. I don't have a big one here, but this is one of the ones that was probably done at that point in time. And this probably was done for a lithograph or some type of other, with the squares, you know, it's all line. He designed windows for he designed Tiffany glass, and he did cathedral windows in New York. Ultimately, though, and I'm backtracking a bit, in 1885 he developed diphtheria, which is when he moved. The doctors recommended that he have a change in environment, and he went to Blowing Rock, North Carolina. And ultimately, from 1885 until his death in 1932, kind of spent time between the two. In 1910, which is, let's see where the big one, when this painting was performed of the Grand Canyon with kind of his imaginary city in it, he was, along with four other artists, was commissioned by the Santa Fe Railway to go depict the Grand Canyon to hopefully increase tourism to that area. He was there with Potast and with Thomas Moran. So some fairly well-known artists went with him at that time. From these sketches that he did, he ultimately did a painting called The Genius of the Canyon, which was complete in 1913 and sold at auction for $15,000, which in 1920, which was the highest amount ever paid for a living artist in the United States at that time. He ultimately wrote books in the early 1790s on Ennis, and then in the 1920s, he wrote a book on Blakelock. In 1924, he went to Europe to visit again, developed a blood clot, and really never recovered from that point in time, and was in failing health for the remainder of his life. Now the new museum is in Blowing Rock, and is really, at least I haven't seen it yet, but Dave says it is really quite a spectacular thing if you get a chance to visit. This is one of his landscapes. And even though when we think of him, you think about what did he do, and he was influenced by the Barbizon School, Hudson River, the Impressionist, the Symbolist, and then, of course, he was working with Blakelock and with Albert Pinkham Ryder, who used all of these unusual glazes as well. So a very unusual technique. But this is very typical of his landscapes. Again, one from the Malay period. This is selling water lilies. One of his allegorical figures. and this little whimsical sort of nymph figure that he did, a pastel. Otherwise, I really have nothing else to say about these artists.